Our opening hymn is hymn 756, which is printed for us in our bulletin. We walk by faith and not by sight. May God bless your worship. with you.
Then the word of the Lord came to him,
This man will not be your heir, but a son coming from your own body will be your heir. He took him outside and said, look up at the heavens and count the stars, if you indeed can count them. Then he said to him, so shall your offspring be. Abraham believed the Lord, and he credited it to him as righteousness. This is God's holy word. Let's join in singing the psalm of the day, Psalm 33, which is on page 79.
People who say such things show that they are looking
for a country of their own. If they had been thinking of the country they had left, they would have had opportunity to return. And so they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. This is God's holy word. The verse of the day. Hallelujah. Now faith is being sure of what we hope for, and certain of what we do not see. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
faith in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our word of meditation this morning is our epistle lesson, Hebrews chapter 11, as on page 4. We go into that quite a bit throughout the sermon, so we want to open up to that page. Dear brothers and sisters, the Golden State Warriors broke the record for the most wins in a regular season in the NBA this past year. They are arguably the greatest regular season team in NBA history. So everyone expected them to also win the NBA playoffs. They made it all the way to the finals where they faced the Cleveland Cavaliers. After four games, they were up 3-1. They only needed one more game to cement their legacy as one of the best teams ever. All the sports radio hosts, all the analysts thought, for sure, the Warriors are going to win. They only needed one more game out of three, and they hadn't lost three games all season. Or three games in a row all season. They were a sure thing. Everyone was certain that the Warriors were going to come out on top. Except, they didn't. The Cavs won the next three games and became the first team to ever come back. The Warriors lost what most thought was a certain victory. What's the difference between that confidence that the Warriors had in their victory and the confidence that Hebrews 11 talks about when talking about faith? Faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. The Warriors were sure that they were going to win. There was no way they were going to lose. What's the difference? And this isn't just an academic question. How often have our hopes been disappointed? Haven't there been times that you were so sure that something was going to happen, only to find out later that it wasn't so? Or have you ever been accused of having blind faith, believing something that is out of step with the rest of the world? What makes your Christian faith different? The writer to the Hebrews, instead of really stating what the difference is, shows us that difference by listing believers from old. And as we look at a small portion of that list today, we're going to really see what that difference is. He starts by taking us back to the very beginning. He writes, "By faith we understand that the universe was formed at God's command, so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible." Why do you believe that God created the world in six regular days? You weren't there to see it. No one else was there to tell you about it. In fact, many of the highest authorities in science and the greatest intellects in our world deny that simple statement. They argue that the evidence shows a gradual change over time and evolving from simple to complex. If you go to any natural history museum or if you watch the opening of the Olympics for that matter, you will see them lay out steps of evolution over millions and billions of years. Now, we could go back to them and argue over the evidence that they interpret and say, no, this really matches what God's word says. But would that bring sureness and certainty? At best, that would leave everything in doubt. But that's the opposite of faith. So why is faith so sure and certain that the universe was formed at God's command so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible? Are you so sure because it's degrading to think that you come from a monkey or a microbe? Are you so confident because you need something bigger to believe in and to lean on? That's true, those things are, if they're the reason for your faith, then your faith is really no bigger than the Warriors' faith and their victory. You believe only because you want to believe. That's not what the ancients were commended for. Why did they believe? And why do we believe that God created all things? Because God says so. He alone was the eyewitness And he tells us in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And it's not just Genesis 1 and 2 that tells us that, even though that would, should be enough. But it's woven throughout the scriptures. Exodus 20 says, in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them. Psalm 33, which we sang today. By the word of the Lord were the heavens made. Psalm 124 calls God the maker of heaven and earth. The prophet Isaiah says, it is I who made the earth and created mankind upon it. Jesus himself said, at the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. And that's just a sample. There'd be a lot of pages you have to tear out of the Bible to hold on to evolution. So your faith is sure of what you hope for and certain of what you do not see. Not because it really makes you feel good or because it sounds reasonable or that you seek it yourself, because the way was there. But rather, that's what God says. And he is reliable. He is trustworthy. He is true. That's what gives your faith its sureness and certainty. That's brought out all the more as we look at Abraham. Why did Abraham leave his homeland and go to a place that he had never seen? Did he dream big, imagining that he would set down firm roots once he got there? So many of the day suppose that faith means to dream big, to have confidence in yourself to accomplish your goals. If that had been the case, Abraham would have died disappointed. For he never owned more land in the field and the cave than he was buried in. You see, faith doesn't mean to dream big. So why didn't Abraham go? Look at verse 18. By faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. Why did he go? Because God called him to do so, and God made a promise to Abraham. Abraham's descendants would one day possess the land, and later through them the Savior would come and bring blessings to all people on earth. That's an inheritance. Abraham never saw any evidence of that. Remember, he died only owning his burial plot. But God's promise is all the evidence that Abraham needed. Abraham wasn't simply dreaming big. He was counting on the promises of God. So sure and certain was Abraham that God would keep his word that he left the land he knew and lived and died as a stranger in a foreign land. Faith takes God at his word. Faith is sure and certain because God is trustworthy and true. So also Abraham believed that he and his wife Sarah would have a son. He believed, even though Sarah was barren, they were both too old. He believed, not because he just wanted it so bad. Yes, he did want a son, but that's not why he believed. He believed because God had promised it. We see that in verse 11. Abraham considered him faithful who had made the promise. Faith is sure and certain because God is faithful. He is trustworthy and true. So look to God's promises. They alone give you and your faith that real sureness, that true certainty. Think about it. When something is promised, you haven't seen it happen yet, right? If I promise the catechism class that I'm going to bring a really great treat on the first day of class, there's no proof that they can see it. There's only my word. That promise is the only evidence that it will happen. And I may prove unreliable for one reason or another. But God is trustworthy and true. His promises are more reliable than any evidence that you can see or touch or reason out. His promises are the unseen proof that give faith its sureness. They are the unseen evidence that drives away doubt. Faith is certain of what we do not see because of God's promises. And it is these promises that give us our hope. If you promise a child that you're going to take him to the fair coming up, his face will probably light up. But after you've kept that promise, hope is replaced with a fun time at the fair and with pleasant memories afterwards. Hope looks forward. It eagerly anticipates what we do not yet have. The promise holds out that holds on to that future good. Faith trusts that promise, and therefore faith hopes. Now, human promises fail. Hope easily ends in disappointment. But how different God's promises are. The hope God's promises bring are as real and as sure as if they actually already happened. His promises do not fail. His promises give our faith and hope a reality. So that what he has promised is more real in this world than I actually see and touch. Hope that believes God's promises will not be disappointed, because God is trustworthy and true. And look, dear Christians, what God has promised to you, who through faith are citizens of Christ's kingdom. Because of God's promise, verse 10 says, Abraham was looking forward to the city with foundations, whose architect and builder is God. That's the hope that God's promise gives to your faith as well. Abraham knew that he was a stranger. He wasn't just a foreigner in the land of Canaan, though. He was a stranger on this earth. His fatherland, his home country, was not Ur of the Chaldeans, where he had been born. He could have returned there if he thought that was his fatherland. His fatherland was not Haran, where his father died. And it wasn't Canaan, either. His son and his grandson lived in tents as temporary residents of Canaan. But look at verses 13 through 16. They admitted that they were aliens and strangers on earth. People who say such things show that they are looking for a country of their own. If they had been thinking of the country they had left, they would have had an opportunity to return. Instead, they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Dear friends, live as foreigners on this planet, longing to go home. And I'm not talking about 1 hour space, I'm not talking about I'm talking about heaven. Even though we haven't been there, heaven is your home. Jesus has made it your true home. He's preparing a place for you right now. Heaven is your fatherland. For you have been reborn in the water and the spirits of baptism, reborn as a citizen of heaven, so that God is not ashamed to be called your God and claim you as his people, because you have been washed clean in the blood of his Son, Jesus Christ. That blood that was shed on the cross for all of your sins. Just think about how often you doubt the promises of God. Think about how often you are drawn to the things of this world. How often you and I scurry about in this world, in this strange, sinful place. How often you and I don't long for heaven, but long for a bigger house, or a better job, or more money. Jesus has died for those sins. And every other sin that haunts me. Jesus paid the price for our transgressions, so that we might be made into a new creation, trusting in the promises of God, clinging to the hope that is found in the gospel of Christ. Your faith clings to Jesus' righteousness as your only plea that stands before God. It's not Peter or Paul who stand at the gates of heaven and let people in. It is Jesus himself who welcomes you into your true home with arms wide open. We're not home yet, beloved. We're still strangers on this earth. We're living by faith, looking forward in hope to the promised inheritance. So don't grow attached to the things of this earth. This life passes away so easily. Rather, keep your eyes on the distance. Keep your eyes on that welcomed inheritance that is waiting for you. Keep your eyes on the cross. Yes, this life is filled with its disappointments, pains, troubles, sorrows, and so forth. But don't let those dampen the hope that is found in Jesus Christ and the home that he has prepared for you. Like Abraham, live by faith. Faith that is sure and certain because of God's promises, because God is trustworthy and true. The hope his promises bring do not disappoint, but always prove to be true. As you continue in faith, holding on to God's promises, no and nothing can rob you of your citizenship in its heavenly city. That is what's waiting for you in faith. Amen. The peace of God, which transcends understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. Please stand as we sing the prayer of David, which is on the top of page 8.
Give us teachers and students
Give fathers and mothers a renewed commitment to be good parents. Give children and young people the wisdom to regard their parents as your representatives.
Lead us to love one another as you have loved us.
O God, the strength of the weak and the comfort of sufferers, mercifully hear our prayers and grant to your servants Angela Keebler, who is still hospitalized, Joyce Gibson, who is recovering from pneumonia, Sherry Burmeister, friend of Gary and Judy Mittner, who has been diagnosed with cancer. Also give strength to Marielle Brocklehurst, Larry Gunthorpe, Harold McBride, and Sue Spencer, all who are recovering from surgery. Give them the help of your power, that their sicknesses and injuries may be turned into health, and any of their anxieties into joy, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Almighty God, source of all mercy and giver of all comfort, deal graciously, we pray, with the family and friends of Rob Slocum, family friend of Al Waldron, who was killed in a motorcycle accident this past Thursday. We pray that casting all of their sorrow on you, they may know the consolation of your love through your Son, Jesus Christ, their Lord. And hear us, Lord, as we bring you our private petitions. Gracious Father, we pray boldly as Jesus taught, with the confidence that you will hear and with the faith that you will respond for our welfare.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into
of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
Take a drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, poured out for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Take a drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, poured out for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Now may the strength and preserve you in the true faith until life everlasting. Depart in peace. Your sins are forgiven. Take and eat. This is the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given unto death for all of your sins.
Thank you.
Once again, good morning. So glad to worship with you. You know, during my sermon and in our meetings today, talks about creation and how God created the world and the opposite of evolution. If you're ever interested in learning more about creation science and kind of how to help defend your faith, apologetics, that's called, just see me. I have tons of books and DVDs on creation and evolution. I have so much stuff. So just ask me for something and I can do it for you. Couple of announcements here. Number one, Art Bible Camp is going to be August 16th through 18th, so next week. And we need lots of help for that. Please consider helping out one or more nights. See the bulletin for information. There's a sign-up sheet on the bulletin board. If your children are wanting to come, please get them signed up. And you do that through the website, just like soccer talk. Speaking and we need to have them signed up so we have enough materials. Speaking of soccer Bible camp, big thanks to everyone who helped. I forgot to take the count. Pastor Berger, you didn't do that, did you?
No.
We don't know how many people. Amy, do you know how many people helped? No, that's kids. How many helpers? 40-some helpers or so. A lot from our church, a lot from Emmanuel, a lot from Zion as well. So a lot of helpers. And we had about 118 kids, which was great. Had a good year. We had a different location this year. We shopped a lot. A little hot, but we got through. And it was a lot of fun. Thanks to everyone. Just, you know, we bought snacks, drinks, help register, help actually coach, whatever. Fourth thing, we are doing a Bible study on Sunday mornings. And it's called The Bloodstained Path to God, as we look at some of the Old Testament ceremonies and practices that pointed ahead to Christ. So far, we looked at Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. We looked at like the cleansing laws. Today, we looked at the tabernacle and how it was shaped. And there's one thing I forgot to mention, and I may as well tell you now, so that we can get ready for next week, as we look at some of the festivals and how the priests were set up. Our altar. Why do we have an altar in our church? And it is actually supposed to remind us of the Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant was set behind the veil so that only the high priest was allowed to see the Ark of the Covenant once a year, the place where God dwelt. When Jesus died, that veil was torn in two from top to bottom, thus symbolizing that God and man are now communicating with each other. We don't have a veil covering our altar because we are in God's presence through faith in Jesus Christ. So there's a little something for you. You can look forward to our Bible class. That's the kind of things we talk about in Bible class. Take some time to greet your fellow worshipers. Don't forget about the fellowship in the back. Have a great day. Have a God bless you.